Det är det man ska. It's good to be back. It's actually my sixth time in the city, so I mean, it almost feels like home away from home. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I don't know. Because
this is more formal.
This is more informal, so I'm going to try and speak with my own voice. What I'm going to do today is to tell you the history of Icelandic music, but I'm going to paint a sonic picture with a very wide brush, if you understand what I'm saying. I'm not going to tell the whole story. I'm going to pinpoint one aspect of the Icelandic music that to me makes Icelandic music feel and sound like Icelandic music. You maybe noticed that when you hear a band from Iceland, it can be pop, rock, metal, even like we had reggae just now. That's Icelandic reggae. And a lot of times people say that regardless of style, it always sounds a little bit Icelandic. Do you agree? And I'm going to sort of take you down a history of Icelandic music and pinpoint what I feel is the key element to the Icelandic sound. I call this melancholy, because there's like in Iceland and the culture and the music, there's like this inherent melancholy. And hopefully in 60 minutes or something, you'll understand better my point of view. Now, Dima, let's say, see the first slide.
Meet my friend, he's also named Ragnar.
Vikings. It's how it all started. And the Vikings that came to Iceland and stayed were Norwegian Vikings. And they left Norway because of religion. Harald the Hårfagre, one of the kings, was trying to unite Norway under one crown, and also under the Christian religion. And the pagans didn't like that, so they sailed across the Atlantic, and they sailed to, well, the Faroe Islands and Iceland. So religion played a part in Iceland, the Icelandic settlement. And for the first 150 years or so, the Vikings were just pagan. They believed in the Norse gods, Odin, Thor, Freya, etc. And little is known, we don't really know what the Vikings sang, what kind of music they played, because at the time there was no notation, there was no recording technology, so we can only sort of assume that the music they played and listened to at the time was something that, you know, all Vikings in Scandinavia listened at the time. And we don't know, because the only thing we have are written texts, we have poetry and poems. But the Vikings who went to Iceland, they passed by Ireland, so it's pretty safe to say that there are some Celtic influence in the first early music of Iceland. And I'm just going to check my emails. That's my notes. So, but the oldest recorded, documented piece of music we have in Iceland, it's a hymn. And it's in fact the oldest hymn, like Nordic hymn, that's been documented. And it's a hymn called Heyr Himnasmir. And it's written by a poet called Kolbeinn Tumason. And he wrote that in September 1208. So the history of Icelandic music that's been documented is exactly 810 years. That's the time span I'm going to span today in the lecture. In the year 1000, monks, crusaders from Europe came to Iceland. They wanted to, have the Icelanders to turn to Christian religion, believe in God. And that was actually easier than you would think, because the Icelanders already had like so many gods. So they thought, well, we can just add one more, you know, the more the better. So for about 200 years, the Icelanders, they believed both in Odin and those guys, and God, Jesus. But around the year 1200, Iceland became pretty much a Christian country. So this oldest hymn called Heyr Himnasmiður, it has Christian content. It's the poet is writing to his God, his Savior. And the poet I mentioned is called, was called Kolbe Tumason. He was a poet, and he was also a chief of a clan. And Icelanders, they had many clans, and there were many clan wars. They were fighting each other. And one thing you have to realize, being a Viking in Iceland, there was no forest, so no wood to make shafts for axes or weapons. So there was no iron to make spearheads and axes. So the Icelanders, they didn't really have many weapons. And so the great battles of Iceland were actually fought by throwing rocks. not as cool as this, you know. So this is a poet, Kolbe. He went out to a battle, and I guess he kind of knew that he was going to die that day, because the before he went to that battle, he wrote this hymn called "Heilhimmasmiður," where he's begging his God, the God, to watch over him, guide him, and save his soul. And he went to battle, and he got a rock to his head and killed him. So died by rock. Let's see the next slide, you know. And here's my band, Arstir, singing this oldest hymn, "Heilhimmasmiður," at a train station on tour in Germany. So let's hear some of that. Motion, and that's the Gregorian chant that the monks brought to Iceland when they came to Iceland in the year 1000 and further. Now, the Gregorian chant is the foundation of all Western music, actually, because they not only did they invent the notation system where you can notate the notes, so music could be documented, not just kept alive orally, but could be documented for the first time. But also they invented the church modes, basically the foundation of the music theory as we know it today. However, that came later, so when the monks came to Iceland, they only brought this single unison singing, where there's no music theory, there's no contrapunt, there are no voicings, everybody sings in unison. Sometimes in an octave, but in the same notes. So, and then after that, I was going to mention also that the fact that the Gregorians did this, and did this for many, many hundred years, was because the church didn't like the fact that that monophonic singing was a great symbol for the unity of the church. Also, this one God, so one melody. And also, the church, the Roman church, believed for many, many years that if music became too beautiful, it would be to overshadow the one perfect thing, the most perfect thing in the world, which is God himself. So the church actually resisted polyphony for many, many years. But yeah, later, of course, as we know, they started adding harmonies, and 200 years later we have Bach, Mozart, Beethoven. However, in Iceland, around the 1200s and on, Iceland became very, very isolated. So there was no news coming from the continent. So the Icelanders just sat there on their little rock in the Atlantic Ocean and didn't get the memo that we now have polyharmony. So Iceland, they kept to a Gregorian style of singing for many, many years. Also, you have to realize that in Iceland, because the same reason they couldn't make weapons, they couldn't make instruments. There was no wood to make instruments from. So singing back then and to this day is like the most Icelandic thing to do. Icelanders sing. But then the Icelanders, they sort of thought that we might, you know, add some harmony, but they added harmony without the music theory that we know from Western style music. And they added one voice to the main voice. And the strongest interval of all intervals, except for the octave, is the fifth. You know where fifth is, right? So, you have a melody, and this is the octave, and the fifth is this one. And in Western theory, you have rules regarding modes and music theory that dictates how intervals change when you change when the melody travels or a chord or a context. The Icelanders did not know that, so they just kept the fifth moving parallel to the melody, which gives you this sound. So it sounds dissonant, and it is, because it's disregarding music harmony as we know it. And it sounds cold, it sounds Viking, very much like Vikings. And it sounds melancholic. So remember the lecture is called Melancholy, and this is, I'm going to explain why I think the fifth and the tradition of the fifth, the Icelandic singing the fifth, is one thing that makes up the trademark of the Icelandic musical heritage. We can do the next slide and play the video. This is a song where they use fifths. They actually change the bass part, sings the tenor part at one point, and the tenor sings the bass, but all the intervals are always in the fifths, unison fifths.
Island far side from.
All kids sing this in school and kindergarten, and something that all the students grew up with. It's a song about the raven, and the raven, of course, has is connected to Odin, the god from Norse mythology. He had two ravens who flew all over the world and saw everything. That's why he could see everything. So let's see the next slide and listen to the song Krummeister. And there you will hear a simple melody and then the voicing adds in the second verse and it's just moving in parallel fifths.
Krummi svaf í klettagjá, kaldri vetrar lóttu á, verður margt að meini, fyrr en dagur fagur rann, freðin nefi dregur hann, undan stórum steini, allt frosið út í vor, ekkert fæst við ströndum vor, svengdur metti mína, Ef að húsum heimegt heim að fattur bannar mér, sepp úr sorpa tína, öll þakin í sig jörð, ekki séð á valka börn, fleygir fuglar geta, en þó reyti út mó, auða hvergi lítur tó, hvað á hrafna veta,
So what you hear there is just the same melody, and the voicing jumps one fifth up or mirrored, so it's like a fourth below the melody, which is like a fifth when it's mirrored. How many people are like musicians in here? Raise your hand. Yeah, but I think you can.
What grade?
Huh?
What grade?
No, a musician. Do you play music?
No.
Okay. But yeah, know that this is the fifth. And when they sang unison, they added the fifth, and they always moved parallel. In Western music today, we don't do that anymore. So this is like the. But the Vikings, like I said, they didn't have access to the development of music in Europe. That's why they stuck with this, and stuck with this for 500-600 years.
They're doing it a lot in rock music.
They do it a lot.
They're always playing with fifths.
True. Power chords or fifths. So rock and roll, in a way, that's why I have such great Viking metal, because, you know, a power chord is a fifth. Good point. Thank you, Sadie. But yeah, the fifth is the strongest interval. Now, musicians today in Iceland, who they of course grew up with this, and knowing the fifth singing, sometimes they will use it as an element, and deliberately do it so to make the music sound more Icelandic. And you can see the next slide and hear a song by Björk called The Yoga, and the cellos will be playing fifths. Still just stuck to the fifth singing. And they tried to vary their singing without theory. They would try to figure out how can we make variations on the fifths. And one easy way to make a musical variation without changing the theory is to sing in canon. Do you know what canon is? Yeah, so one starts a melody, and then you start the same melody but one bar afterwards, and then you'll have accidental harmonies. And I want to play you a song by my band Austin,
we wrote a song called Here, Here, Unni. And we started by singing the whole band together in unison, like the Vikings did. And then the song develops, and we use a lot of fifths in the lower two voices. Of course, we also use modern type contrapunt, but at the bass, you'll hear a lot of fifths. And towards the end of the song, you'll hear some canon singing. And all those three things we did deliberately to reference the sort of Icelandic heritage. They also wrote a lot of poetry as well, and another style of singing developed alongside the fifth singing. It's called rimna sungur, or the songs are called rimr. And those were closer to being recited poetry, but the poetry was recited in notes and a special type of singing. And these songs were more the songs of the everyday people, the normal people, not maybe the poets. People would just sing about, you know, whatever was happening in their life. You know, some rim were actually almost like pornographic, or whatever people experienced in their life, they would compose these everyday poems called rimr and recite them a certain way. And they did this for 500 years, and nothing really changed. Like I said, Iceland is very isolated, so there's no incoming outside influence. And scholars today, when they write about rimr, they all point out that this is not very high art. This is like a low art. It's like pulp fiction for Icelandic Vikings. But it is our heritage. It's all we had. So today we still have some singers who specialize in the old style of singing rimr. And next we're going to see a snippet where Sigurós, the band from Iceland, they made a collaboration with Iceland's most famous rimnasöngari called Steindur Andersen. And you'll hear Sigurós play music, and then you hear him sing in this very special style of singing called rimnasöngur. And yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Some say it might be because of the lack of instruments, but don't really buy that. I think there must have been some instruments in the old days, but you know, it's very interesting, you know, for us because we're kind of learning about things as well, exploring them, like the rim, you know, the old, you know, chanting style.
Style of singing called Rindlarsöngur. And you can hear it, it sounds sad, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Even though it's like the songs of the people, that everybody would make these rímur, and they would sing about their horse or their loved ones or you know, whatever. But it still sounds melancholic, do you agree? Mm-hmm. So this is, it's like whatever music we have, it always has this looming sadness into it. And let's see. Here comes my next point, why I call this lecture melancholy, because in the years from the 1200s to the early 1800s, Icelanders did not really have much to be happy about. Like I said, they were isolated from the rest of the world, and they had no sort of connection with outside countries, and stuff like wheat, sugar, stuff you need for cooking, eating, you didn't really have that. And so there was a lot of famine. It was too cold, people couldn't grow anything. The only thing people could eat were sheep. And the word for money in Iceland is fia, which means sheep. Basically, that's all you had to survive was sheep, and people ate that the whole year round. Because also at that time, they did not have the technology to fish, and they didn't have greenhouses to grow stuff. So there's a lot of famine, a lot of natural disasters, volcanic eruptions that sort of made the climate even more inhabitable. Did you know that the French Revolution was triggered by an Icelandic volcano? It was Hekla, and so much ash came to the air that the crops all over Europe failed for 2 years. So all the ash that spread to the air in Europe made that the crops did fail for 2 years. So the farmers in France, they were so hungry that they decided to overthrow the king. But imagine how the Icelanders felt, you know, living in the same island as the volcano. Also, the Black Death hit Iceland twice. First time it killed 60% of the whole population. Second time it killed 50% of the remaining 40%. So death was very much a part of the family. Icelandic reality was very much about death. So in these years, years from the 1200s on to the early 1800s, a lot of this stuff that people wrote poetry about and sang about were what was on top of the mind, which was death. And there's a lot of, at this time, there's a lot of superstition that develops. Of course, you know elves, people believe in elves, people believe in trolls, people believe in ghosts. And they believe in every single monster imaginable. Like they were afraid of everything. And there's a lot of creepy ghost stories. And of course, the superstition and the belief in ghosts and spirits, they found its way into, of course, music. So there's a lot of
folk songs that we have from those years that are very, very creepy. And next we're going to hear a song called Molumin Cri Cri. And the story is, there was a woman who had a baby outside wedlock. She was not married. And that was a sin at the time, and also people could get in trouble for it. So when the baby was born, she took her shawl, like to wrap around her, and she wrapped the baby, the newborn baby, into the shawl, walked into the lava field, and left the baby to die. And that was done a lot. It was like, these are hard times. Now, a couple of years later, the same woman gets married, and she's going to a dance, to dance at a ball. And she looks around at her home, looking for something to wear on the ball, to look nice. And all of a sudden, she hears this ghostly voice, and it's the voice of her dead child singing to her, singing, "Mom, you can have my shawl." So let's hear the song. Next slide. Yeah, I think I covered all this, so let's do the next slide. Hear the song. So the dead baby singing to her mother. Now we're going to move on to some more fun stuff. In the 1800s, Iceland was governed by the Danes, under the Danish crown, and they had more and more connections with Denmark. So more food still coming in. The Danes sent over some flour and stuff to make bread, and also some Icelanders could travel to Copenhagen. And the first musical instruments that come to Iceland, usually there were organs, like pump organs, or accordions. And to this day, every Icelander still hates accordions because that's the only thing we had for a long time. Iceland had its first bona fide composers in the 1800s. It was Jonas Helgason or Sveppjason. So it wasn't until like 150 years ago that we had actual composers who composed music using contrapunt and the rules as we know today. In the 1930s, the first radio station opened. So, that was a huge leap in the development of Icelandic music, because all of a sudden you can hear music, not just sing it around the organ or the accordion at home. And of course, then you can also hear music from outside Iceland. So, Icelanders in Iceland could hear a little bit of Icelandic music. Mostly accordion music, but that's a different story. And also to sort of paint the picture, because of the lack of wood, all these years Icelanders had been living in houses that were like dug into the ground, because there was no wood to make the houses. Sometimes they would pile, walls from stones, pile stones, and make a roof, had grass on the roof. But it's almost like hobbits living in like houses dug into the ground.
Elves. Elves.
Not elves live. They live in rocks. Icelanders just lived in houses dug into the mountain. Very similar though. So when Eisner saw it,
I've read like tales, fairy tales, and I've known about elves.
Yes.
And the Russian scientist Leonid Korablev, he has given the money from the Icelandic government.
Yeah.
And he believes in elves.
Yeah.
And so he has believed this. In his books, he made pictures which have given elves from Turkey to a church.
Yep, there you go. And we can talk more about this in the Q&A after the lecture. It was a good point, because with all this superstition going on, the belief in elves, even though nobody really believes them today, the tradition and the superstition lasted for a long, long time. I hope you can see why Eisner has had to believe in. But now we're in the 1930s, we've got the radio station, and then we had the biggest leap in music history. When the Second World War happened. Why? Because, first of all, we gained independence from the Danes, but also we were invaded by first the Britons and then the Americans. They just came to Iceland and made an army base. Iceland has never had an army, and still to this day doesn't have an army, so we couldn't really fight them off. And I guess Iceland were kind of happy because the Americans, they brought interesting things like the TV. All of a sudden, the Icelanders, who had been sitting on this rock in the middle of Atlantic, isolated for more than 700 years now, not having any outside influence, all of a sudden they had a window to the rest of the world, and they could see, oh my God, the world just had Bach, Mozart, and then some, and we missed it all. We're so behind. So let's see the next slide. We have independence, we have emergence of all the music styles in a very short time, and I say here down there is everything mania. Like, they were manic. The Icelanders realized we're so much behind the rest of Europe. We're living in the Middle Ages while the rest of the world has had all these developments. And realizing this, they became manic about sort of catching up. So from the year 1944 to this day, Icelanders have been trying to catch up and being obsessed about it. So first we had the emergence of jazz, and in just like 10 or 20 years, Iceland as a jazz scene boomed. And today we have a lot of beautiful jazz standards that are written, composed in Iceland. But it was a very short time where the jazz was happening, so it was still 50 years too late by the time jazz came. Then we had Beatlemania, and that happened sort of around the same time as Beatlemania happened in the rest of the world. So by this time, Icelanders are sort of keeping up to date. And from there on, Icelanders keep sort of synchronized with the rest of the world. But they always still have this sense that we've been a bit behind the times such a long time. So they're obsessing about being with the times and sometimes ahead of the times. But still to this day, this time in the 60s, there was very little of a musical identity. So from the independence 1944 to the 80s, Iceland was just trying to sample everything that came from the outside world. Does that make sense? So it wasn't until later that we started developing this Icelandic sound again. But we'll get to that. Let's see the next slide. So here you have the Icelandic Beatles, Hjómar. And I just want to play you one song from 1963, and this was like the rage in Iceland.
Bye.
warriors, nothing special. It's just the Icelanders turn and mimic what they hear on the radio, right? And at this time we had also pop music for, like these guys were pop stars, all the young kids were just like, wah! Going mad about it. These sort of middle-aged people in Iceland, they listened to a lot of pop, but the pop music, the main pop music in Iceland at these times, we're talking the 60s here, 70s, early 70s, was mostly music that was like foreign music, so German schlagers imported to Iceland and they made Icelandic lyrics for it and sang it in Icelandic. So still we see that the Icelandic identity is just is not formed yet. We're still just sort of trying to import as much as we can. This summer you'll have the World Cup of football in Russia. We're going to have a lot of Icelanders going around saying, if you go to a football match or if you see Icelanders, you'll also hear them singing a song, "Yeah, I'm coming home." And that's a song called "Yeah, Come Home." It's like kind of like Liverpool has "You Never Walk Alone." Icelandic football team, the supporter team, they have adopted this song from the 60s. It's actually an Hungarian schlager with Icelandic lyrics. So my point here is we're still waiting for the Icelandic identity, the Icelandic music to emerge. And it all began with this lovely woman.
Björk.
That's our queen, Björk. Of course, she's like the face for a movement, the punk movement, and of course she was not alone. But she really symbolizes the change, because when punk happened, Iceland was of course up to date with the times. But here, they start sort of, we see that the Icelanders are adopting this punk mentality, and they're venturing beyond their influences from outside. They are experimenting. So today we have a lot of experimental genre bending music, and it all happened this year, 1981, 1982, when the punk attitude let people just be not afraid of just trying different things, trying new sounds, not just copy what they heard on the radio or TV, but make new sounds. This poster is from a movie called Rock í Reykjavík, and these are the bands who figured in the movie, and for an Icelander, this list is just like incredible bands who really shaped the beginning of what we know today as the Icelandic music scene and the Icelandic music phenomena. And yeah, like I said, people were still obsessing about not being behind the times, so they tried everything to be ahead of the times. Let's get to the next slide. Oh yeah, Björk, she did a lot of punk, and she also did a lot of jazz. I mean, like every musician in Iceland today, she tries a lot of different genres. But when Sugarcubes, her band Sugarcubes came, that was the first time Iceland had music that was exported. Like, that was not just made for Icelanders. They, for the first time, they traveled to the rest of the world. So you see what my point here is. After being behind the times, have no influences from outside Iceland, now tables turned. Iceland has something to present to the rest of the world. And I want to let you hear some bars from this song called Birthday.
Thank you.
first sort of international export in music, the shillelagh. This song was a big hit in the UK, and the shillelagh even played in Russia. Were you anyone there? No. Yeah. But yeah, like, shillelagh has changed a lot, and in the following years, we have a whole new generation growing up in Iceland, believing that you can make weird music and you can go outside and play. And I'm here today, so I'm sort of a part of the Icelandic export. But it all started with the song Birthday and our queen Björk. Before Björk, of course, some bands in Iceland had tried to, you know, play outside Iceland. You remember the Beatles band I let you hear? They tried to go to the UK and make it, and they changed their names to Thor's Hammer. But at that time, because they didn't have anything that was unique, they just sounded just like the Beatles. So they didn't really, Icelandic music did not have anything to offer that was unique to the rest of the world. But with Björk, with the punk mentality, also with the punk mentality, comes this DIY thinking that you do everything yourself. Björk and her friends from the shillelagh, they formed their own label called Smackleser. So from the day one, they owned their own music, they released their own music, they owned all the rights. And today, that's still a big part of how Icelanders think and how they make music. It's very much DIY. There are no big labels in Iceland anyway, so it's always been like this drive, and it all started with these guys. And now, after Björk and the shillelagh, you have the whole new generation of Icelanders growing up and thinking, we can do this, we can make unique music that's weird and still, you know, tour outside Iceland. Let's see the next slide. So, in 1999, this is when Sigurós released their album Ákeðisbyrjun, and this is really where the start of the Icelandic music phenomenon as we know it today. And the post-Björk generation. I'm of course a part of that as well myself. And here you have also what I call a musical boom from the year 1999 to this day. I don't have a number for how many amazing Icelandic bands there are. New bands pop up every day. And the interesting thing about Icelandic bands today, every band has a unique sound. So there's no copycats anymore. There's a lot of experimenting going on. And the experimentation comes from both this obsession about being ahead of the times, not being behind the times like we were for 800 years. We want to be before the times now. There's the punk mentality that we want to do everything ourselves, we're not afraid to pick up an instrument. Even if we don't play the instrument, we'll still pick it up and make something out of it. And also we start to see this more and more, like with Björk, doing the Icelandic fifths in her arrangements. Sigurós performing music with the old rimnasöngari, the old traditional way of singing. My band Árstíð singing the old hymn at a train station. And a lot of Icelandic bands using the Icelandic tongue, or the inheritance, or the musical traditions, sort of tying that to their identity. Exactly. So, and also while doing this, at the core we still have this sort of melancholic feeling to it. So if you see the next slide. These are some Icelandic bands. What I think they all have in common is that they use this heritage. Like the music might be sung in English or Icelandic or both. It might be metal, it might be pop, it might be electronic, but they still connect to the heritage, both musically in ways of theory or non-music theory, but also like the way they perform the songs, the way the songs sound. There's always this looming melancholy, and I hope you guys agree, and I hope I made sense of this lecture, why it's called melancholy. So that's my point here, is that's like the most Icelandic thing, and I hope I can have explained to you a little bit why that is, that we have this in our fibers, the melancholy. So, let's do some questions. The first one to ask is always the bravest. Yep.
What's your favorite Icelandic band?
I'd say it's Siguros. I used to live in Sweden when I was younger. My parents studied there when I was a kid. So I remember when I got this CD, I'll get this video in 1999 from Siguros. That's the day when I decided to move back to Iceland, because I just felt the calling. Good question. Another thing I forgot to mention, we had also a bank crash in 2008, where Iceland had been modernized for many years. It was a developing country. I told you we were like hobbits 150 years ago, living in houses dug into the ground. And until 1973, Iceland was a developing country, so we had the Marshall help from the United States to rebuild the country. And then we had the economic boom that ended with a crash in 2008. And the crash in 2008 heralded another sort of musical boom. People lost faith in money, lost faith in politicians, lost faith in banks, and they turned even more to music, and especially traditions. So in 2008, there's sort of a huge rise of folk-inspired Icelandic bands. Mosses and Men started that year. My band Orsti was formed in the same month as the banks crashed, in August 2008. Coincidence? Maybe, but this bank crash really made people turn away from material values and turn to culture values. And there was a huge rise in folk music and Icelandic folk inspired music in Iceland.
You told us that there are a lot of bands in your country and they are all unique, but are they in all genres, like all possible genres, or only this punk genre? Or?
Yeah, good question. So now we have every single genre that is in the world we have in Iceland. Sorry, but the problem is there's so few people in Iceland, and there's not enough people to populate every genre. Like for instance, when I lived in Gothenburg and played music there, we had the rockers over here, we had the jazz people over here, we had the classical people over here, we had the punks over here, but nobody talked to each other. Iceland is so small, so in order to populate all the different genres, every musician in Iceland usually plays in two or three or four different genres. Like my friend Kelly from Agent Fresco, he is a drummer in a fantastic progressive metal band, but he's also the drummer who plays with all the hip-hop artists, and he's a jazz drummer. So in one day in Iceland Airways, you can see him play with like three different genres. And myself, I play, I play metal, I produce for Eurovision, I got Arstir, now I've got my solo project. So it's sort of the size of the country pushes people to wear many musical hats. So every musician in Iceland has skills in all the genres. So when they set out to make their own music, it naturally blends, and that's why they sort of why it can sound so unique, because people are not afraid to blend genres and to meet across the borders of the music stance. Good question.
Is hip hop popular in Iceland recently?
Very much. And the thing about hip hoppers, they only rap in Icelandic. So there's a huge the Icelandic tongue is like back in vogue. I mean, it's the most popular style in Iceland as rap, and it's all in Iceland. So it's once again tying back to like the heritage, in this case the language. Even though they rap about whatever they rap about, whatever problems they have in their life, they rap about in Icelandic. And people often make a reference between rap and the old way of reciting poetry called the Ragnarsson. It's melodic spoken poetry, and so there's like a red line going from the Rimnes and Good back in like the 1500s and then rap today.
Would you drop some
bands? It's not my specialty, but I mean, and the cool thing is we have rap bands from Iceland touring outside Iceland, rapping in Icelandic. That's pretty cool. Like Ulvur Ulvur, Emsugauti. Are two names that I know are touring a lot outside Iceland, rapping in Iceland.
Oh, I thought about me. I'm an engineer, but I am engineer. Yeah. But I am interested in the culture. I know who is Snorri Sturluson.
Snorri
Sturluson. I've read poetic Edda, young Edda, and I've respected Icelandic culture very much. Because Icelandic cats have written about Russian history. Do you know?
I don't know.
They have written about the Davidius. What does Icelandic think about Snorri Sturluson, poetic Edda, and young Edda?
Okay, cool.
And Icelandic Sabbath. I the first Icelandic Sabbath is cool. Because I like short sagas. Because the most sagas is what, because I'm not Icelandic.
Mm-hmm.
Because Icelandic sagas sometimes it was dull for me. Because some such as Yao saga. And so, I like more poetic Edda and young Edda by Snorri Sturluson.
Mm-hmm.
And modern studies thinks about their great legacy.
Which has nice thing about the legacy?
About legacy. About Snorri Sturluson, about Vikings, about their blood, about their soil.
Yeah, I think, Icelanders, they sort of reference it more in ways of expression, mood, statistically, musically, they reference the heritage, but nobody really sings about Snorri Sturluson. But there's a metal band called Skarmot, who's doing this really good, they play Viking metal, and they sort of reference the Mastani sagas in the lyrics. And they also do a very good job at using the traditional way of singing, you understand? And using the aesthetic sort of aesthetic Viking style.
Appellation. Ragnar, excuse me, appellation. Mm-hmm. I will talk you about Vikings in Russia.
Please.
Appellation. It will be very interesting.
I'm looking forward to that. Any more questions?
There is also a band called Fluid from Faroe Islands that is doing some metal and voice.
Yeah, Fluid, yeah, exactly. Good point. Sorry? Yeah,
In your last album, there are no songs on a plane.
Yes.
Why is that?
So, I have a band called Ostis. We write both English and Icelandic. And the thing you have to realize is that Icelanders in Iceland, they speak Icelandic to each other. They at work and in school, but they spend half their lives on their phones, their tablets, and the computer, and that's all English language. So, de facto, every human being in the world today is becoming bilingual. So, Iceland is English is a big part of our lives. It's just what it is. And sometimes when I sit down to make music, a feeling or a song will come to me in Icelandic, and sometimes will come to me in English. And it's not something that I decide beforehand, it just happens. So when I made my solo album Urges, this so happened that these songs came to me in English, and the emotion I wanted to express was in English. And then other songs I do in Icelandic.
Hello, Ragnar. I would like to say that I'm your fan and a fan of RCD for more than 6 years.
Nice.
And I'm very glad that you're here today. And I heard news that you will release a new album of RCD in June. So we are all waiting for it. And I would like to ask you about inspiration, creation of the new album. And if you will go to the tour here, or do you plan something about this?
Yeah,
sorry for interrupting, but I would like also to ask you about your own album and about the inspiration. What inspired you to create this new album?
So, the last question, we'll save that for the gig. I'll relay some of the secrets about Urges when we perform the album later. Our students is actually planning a tour in Russia, hopefully this fall. So it'll be hopefully very soon. And the inspiration for the new album came, like it always does, just from life. Our students does not have a concept, not a concept band. We just write about, you know, whatever we go through in our lives. So it's, you know, some love songs and some, you know, life songs.
And so I wish you more inspiration, love, and beautiful things in your soul to create more beautiful things.
Thank you very much. Xenia, how much time do you have? Okay, any more questions? Yes?
You just mentioned that one of your friends is played in some progressive band.
Yeah.
I'm just interested in the name of this band.
Yeah, Agent Fresco. Great band. More questions? Have you tried Haukat?
Yes, we have some dedication here. The next is coming maybe in May. We have recently one. And also we have a dedication of the
Haukat.
Sustrobing.
Yes,
oh,
this
one.
Okay.
It's a great pleasure to be having this lecture in the Scandinavia Club.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, and enjoy the music.